My dear brothers and sisters, the Magnificat, the hymn of the praise of Mother Mary. It is always heartwarming to read this hymn of Mother Mary. My soul rejoices in God my Savior, my spirit praises the Lord my God. Mother Mary rejoicing with great joy, she was praising and thanking God, remembering the great things God has done to the people of God. But then, my dear brothers and sisters, there's something very significant. All this rejoicing, all this praising has a certain context. And the context is very puzzling. You know why? Mother Mary was very troubled. A few sentences before this, the gospel says Mother Mary was very troubled. Why was she troubled? She was troubled because she was given a message that she would conceive and bear a son. She was deeply troubled. For one thing, she did not know what it all meant, that she would conceive and bear a son. A second thing, she did not know how that would happen, because she was not living with a man yet. She was betrothed to Joseph, yes. She was not living with Joseph. And without living with a man, how could a woman conceive and bear a son? She did not understand. A third thing, if that happens, if she conceives and bear a son, she could not even imagine that, because she would be stoned to death. That was the punishment meted out to women who were found pregnant when they were betrothed. And if the man disowns, she would be killed. Too many troubles to disturb her mind. But then, now she is rejoicing. She is praising God. In between these two experiences, something great happened. She made a total surrender of her life in the hands of God. She said, "Here I am, your handmaid. Let it be done to me according to your word." She committed her life completely in the hands of God. And she was anointed by the Holy Spirit. That was the promise she was given, that she would experience the power of the Most High coming upon her. When she made a total surrender of her life in the hands of God, as a result, when she was anointed by the Holy Spirit, the whole attitude changed. The situations remained the same, and yet the way she looked at it was all changed. She knew God was faithful in His promise. If this is God's work, God will make it possible. She completely surrendered her life in the hands of God. And then she was able to rejoice and praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. My dear sisters and brothers, the other day, someone told me, "Father, I don't understand all this." I asked him, "What is it that you don't understand?" He said, "Father, I'm just come for the retreat. Just the second day of the retreat, I'm come with a lot of problems burdening me. I'm come with a lot of troubles in my life." And on the stage, everyone is saying, "Hallelujah, praise the Lord." How can we praise God like this? I'm in distress. I'm in trouble. I don't know why everything is going wrong with my life. I don't know why everybody is turned against me. I don't know why even the best of my intentions are misinterpreted. I'm in deep distress. And everybody is coming to the stage asking us to praise God, to thank God. How can we praise God like that? How can we thank God like that? I told him, this is the system of God. This is the system of God. That's the way God wants us to do things. Whatever is going wrong with our lives, the moment we come in the presence of God and we understand we are brought there by God Himself, God is taking charge. The moment I know God is taking charge, the one thing I need to do is to praise Him, is to rejoice in the presence of God. Hallelujah. As this man said, many of you would have had the same problem when you came for the retreat for the first time. Praise God. Raise your hands up. Someone told me, "Father, I just can't raise my hands up. I'm deeply troubled. My life is weighing down on me. How can I praise God like this?" That is the mystery that I want to explain to you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Jesus Himself has taught us this way of prayer. Jesus was standing by the side of a tomb in Bethany, the tomb of Lazarus. Lazarus was dead and buried 4 days in the tomb. According to the Jewish custom, when someone is buried for 3 days, the relatives, the family members would go open the tomb and embalm the dead body. But with 3 days, that is over. The fourth day, the body begins to decay. Nobody opened the tomb. And that's why Martha said to Jesus. Jesus asked Martha to open the tomb. Martha said, "Master, please, no, do not open the tomb. Because 4 days, the body is decaying and stinking." You know what Jesus did? Jesus stood there and began to praise God. A situation that is miserable. Martha and Mary were in tears. The only brother is dead and gone, become a decaying dead body. And Jesus Himself was shedding tears with deep grief in His heart. And everybody, all the relatives, all the neighbors are come together. Everyone was in distress. Everyone was in sorrow. And yet Jesus stood there and said, John chapter 11, Jesus stood there and said, "Father, I praise You. Father, I praise You. I praise You for you always hear my prayer. Hallelujah. Should all of us raise our hands and say hallelujah. 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 Father, I praise you because you always answer my prayer. This is a confidence. Confidence of faith. Faith in the Father. My Father will always answer my prayer. My Father is always there for me. However terrible, however miserable the situation is, my Father is there for me. If my Father is there for me, no one can be against me. My Father will answer my prayer. That confidence of faith, with that confidence, Jesus began to praise God. And then Jesus said, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out alive. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what Jesus said. That's the way Jesus asked us to pray. Mark 11, 24, 25. Jesus said, when you stand praying, believe what is prayed for is already granted. When you stand praying, believe what is prayed for is already granted. When already granted, what do? We don't ask anymore. We are not disturbed anymore. We are not upset anymore. We just praise. We thank and praise God. My dear sisters and brothers, this is the type of prayer that the Lord has taught us. Down the centuries, this is a type of prayer all the saints have taught us to pray with total confidence. Often our prayer is a prayer of distress. We have problems, we have troubles. We pour out our problems. We pour out our problems, and at the end of it, we become more distressed. We become more upset. We have remembered all the problems, all the troubles, and we go out in tears. We go out in tears. We come in tears. We go out with tears because we did not believe. We did not trust in God. All that we did was to pour out our problems, our woes, and our troubles. I remember a lady came for a retreat. And she told me, Father, I go to the church every day and I pray, but I don't get any consolation from God. She told me her problem. Her husband was a drunkard. Every day he comes home drunk, shouting and screaming. He did not bring any money for the needs of the family. The younger son was a drug addict. He does not even come home. Just once in a while, he would come to ask for money from the mother. But even if the mother did not give him money, he did not care. He was with his friends. He had almost become a trafficker, drug trafficker, from where he got the money, and he was totally lost. The eldest son was working. He was bringing money home to help the mother to run the house. But then he would always blame the mother for the problems of the family. He would sit there in self-pity. I'm the only one to work in this house. How terrible my situation. I have no future. Such a disastrous family life. And she said she would go to the church every day and cry, cry and cry. She would go in crying and come back crying. And she has come for a retreat. She had come for a retreat to cry. And she knew she would go back in tears. I asked her, "My sister, do you believe in God?" What a silly question, right? What a silly question. This is a woman who went to church every day. She said, "Oh, sure, Father, I believe in God. That's why I go to the church every day." I told her, "I really don't think it's the right God you believe in." And she told me later that she had a guilt feeling in her heart. Before marriage, she had committed an abortion. She confessed that sin, but she never accepted pardon from God. She would go on confessing that sin repeatedly, and she would feel terribly guilty, always guilty. How could I do this sin? How terrible a woman I am. I killed my own child. How would God forgive me? God would never forgive me. This was the thing she would tell God. "Oh God, I know you have not forgiven me. You cannot forgive me because I have committed a terrible mistake like that." And she began to blame herself for the husband who was drinking, for the son who was a drug addict, for the eldest son who was desperate because he saw no future for his life. For everything, she would blame herself, and she would slip into self-pity and despair, abiding sorrow. I told her, "My sister, you need to believe in God." To believe in God means believe in a God who loves you. Believe in a God who forgives you. Believe in a God who turns everything to your good. Believe in a God who answers your prayers. You prayed all the time, but you go back from the presence of God in tears. No one who comes to the presence of God should go back in tears, because I believe, my God answers my prayer. My God forgives my sin. My God turns everything to my good. When I know this, when I am convinced of it, when I believe this, when I trust in a God like that, I would never go out of the presence of God in distress. I told her, "You are not able to be consoled even by God, because you don't hear God speaking. All the time you are speaking to God. All the time you are telling God what a terrible worm you are, what a terrible sinner you are. You never wait upon God to tell you, 'My daughter, go in peace. I have forgiven you.' You don't wait upon God to listen to God's voice. Since you don't listen to God's voice, you are not convinced that God loves you. God takes care of you. You do not know who God is." I spoke to her about the prayer of praise. God is right there in the midst of your sin, forgiving you. God is right there in the midst of your problems in the family, taking care of your family. Look upon the face of God. And when you look upon the face of God, when you believe God is forgiving you, God is saving your family, that's when you begin to praise God. Praise is the prayer of one who believes. When I believe, I begin to praise God. I begin to thank God. I begin to worship Him. I begin to rejoice as Mother Mary rejoiced. Mother Mary was in deep trouble. Mother Mary was in distress. And the gospel tells us that she was troubled. And there was every reason to be troubled and distressed. And yet, Mother Mary was rejoicing. Mother Mary was praising God because she believed. And that's what Elizabeth said to Mary. Blessed are you because you believed. And that is the blessedness that we should be having in our prayer life. I told this lady, my sister, you need to look at the face of God. All the time, you are looking at your own face in tears. Look at the face of God who is standing in the midst of your problem, who is standing in the midst of your problem and calls you beyond the problem. And this God is able to forgive you. This God is able to turn everything to your good. This God is love and love and mercy. You trust in God. My dear sisters and brothers, she learned that prayer of praise. She began to feel a consolation in her heart. When she started praising God, when she started believing in God, when she started reading the Word of God and understand how great a love and mercy God is, she began to praise God. She began to thank God for everything. She began to feel a consolation, a joy in her heart. And slowly, everybody in the family began to feel the peaceful presence of the mother. And God could intervene. God could intervene. God could answer her prayer. To cut a long story short, her husband, with the help of the prayer group that she sought, her husband came for a retreat. Also the eldest son. And slowly, the youngest son also came for the retreat. I helped him to go to a rehabilitation center. And this young man is being treated. That family is saved when that family started praising God. Hallelujah. Shall all of us raise our hands and say hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. That is what Christian prayer is. For us to pray means to praise God. Praise God for every trouble, every problem, every situation that looks impossible. Praise God for everything. That's what St. Paul is telling us. In the first letter to Thessalonians chapter 5, you heard it in the first reading. Rejoice always. This is the will of God for you in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always and praise God at all times. Rejoice always and praise God at all times. St. Paul knew this. And that's why in the book of Acts chapter 16, there's a beautiful event. Paul and Silas, the two disciples of Jesus, great Christian witnesses in the early century. The two of them were bound up in prison. Roman prisons were terrible. Roman prisons, you would be bound hand and foot, and you can't even stand up straight in the prison cell, and you would be standing bent down, your hand and foot all tied up in chains. Slowly, the chains would wound your hands and your feet, and so they were in terrible distress. And yet, Paul and Silas, they were praising God. Opening their heart, they were praising God. And this was midnight, at night. They were praising God in pain, in distress. They were praising God, and suddenly God intervened. The psalmist says, God is dwelling in the praises of his people. God is dwelling in the praises of his people. God intervened. and the chains were broken down, and the foundations of the prison cell were shaken up, and the doors were opened, the gates were opened. And the jailer who saw this jailer, he thought the prisoners had escaped, and he would be prosecuted for that. He would be killed for that. And the jailer thought there was no reason to live anymore. He was about to kill himself. That's when Paul said, "Don't harm yourself. We're all here. We have not escaped. We're all here." And later we know this jailer was converted to Jesus Christ. A great miracle occurred in that prison. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But there is one little mention that we could almost forget. The mention is this: when Paul and Silas, they were singing the praises of God, the other prisoners, what were they doing? They could not sleep because they were all like that, bound up in prison. They were listening. They were listening to the praises of Paul and Silas. During a retreat, you often find this. Most of the people will be raising their hands up and praising God. Some people will be standing like that, listening. What's happening? Everybody saying hallelujah. These are hallelujah people. What's happening? They would be listening. Prisoners can only listen. Prisoners can never praise God. Who is a prisoner? A prisoner is a person bound hand and feet. They are the prisoners. Paul and Silas, though they were bound by chains, they were not prisoners really, because they were free. Their hearts were free. They were rejoicing like Mother Mary. They were rejoicing. Their hearts were rejoicing, and they were praising God. They were not prisoners indeed. Though they had chains on their hands and feet, they were not prisoners. They were free inside. When we are prisoners, we will question. We will question. We will be silent. As someone said, good Catholics will never open their mouth in the church. They will open their mouth when a politician would pass that way. They will shout out. When a film star comes that way, or sports star comes that way, they will shout out. They will open their mouth. They will never open their mouth in the presence of God, because they are prisoners to their own sin. There is abiding sorrow in their heart. They are desperate. They are angry. They are prisoners, enslaved to the powers of evil. As long as we are enslaved to the powers of evil, we will never be able to praise God. If you are enslaved to the power of despair or anger or hatred, we will never be able to praise God. Today, the Lord is giving you, my brothers and sisters, the message to be free before God. When we come before God, our hands must go up. When we come before God, we must be able to dance. When we come before God, our mouth should be opened. We must be praising God and thanking God. We should never stand before God as prisoners. That woman I spoke about, that woman was a prisoner, because she was a prisoner to the guilt and sorrow in her heart. The moment she came out of that guilt, the moment she came out of that despair and sorrow, she was able to experience the presence of God, because God dwells in the praises of His people. And God was able to change her life and her family. Today, that says family saved because she learned to pray. Prayer is the prayer of praise.